amazing panel. When you and Mel Gibson got together, where did you find your inspirations for the look of the film?
Well, we really went back to a lot of paintings, a lot of Renaissance paintings. You know, there's been, I mean, not quite 2,000 years of art based on this subject, but and in the end, we never really used any of the paintings as direct references, but they at least gave us an idea of what we could do, because there were so many different representations, we felt comfortable when we were making the movie that we wouldn't make a mistake in terms of how to visually represent things.
Probably the most unique thing about it, number one, they weren't speaking English. And in the beginning, the thought was there was going to be no subtitles. So when I cut it, I kept that in mind. I tried to use things that visually would explain what's going on, because people wouldn't understand what they're saying.
I came onto the picture very late in the process, so Mel and I sort of, and John, had to have some very in-depth discussions right off the bat, and Mel absolutely felt that he wanted a different type of score for the movie, so he didn't really want the traditional, here's the main theme, okay, here's Jesus' theme, and then the heavens open, and he never wanted the music to be cliche. He never wanted it to become its own sort of version of the typical biblical movie.
The early stages of the process were mainly focusing on the makeup. Mel was describing what it is he wanted to see in very specific terms about the look of Christ and what he would endure throughout the film. And in describing what he wanted for the makeup, I was realizing that the conventional methodologies for makeup effects really weren't going to support what Mel was asking for.
Right from the beginning, Keith and I took very seriously that we didn't want you to be able to see any special effects, any makeup or visual effects. A lot of times it was a matter of trying to play things down. If the audience is aware of what we did, we failed. If we push the audience out of this story for a second, we failed.
I really can't think of another film where anybody has done what I would like to say I or we did, but you know, Ted really masterminded the whole thing. Just the idea of covering his body with prosthetics and then really putting digital skin over those prosthetics. Again, it was something I knew could be done and wanted to be done, and it really took advantage of all resources available, again, makeup effects and visual effects.
It's always a challenge when you're working on a movie where you don't understand any of the dialogue. This particular movie, when we mixed it, we didn't even have any subtitles that we were looking at, so when I was mixing it, I didn't know who was saying things that were important and who wasn't. And there's a lot of perspective scenes in this show where there's foreground stuff going on and background stuff going on. And it wasn't until we actually saw at the very last day, we saw a print with titles on it that I had played a line really low because it was the guy way in the back, but that was the line we were supposed to be hearing. So we had to go in and make a bunch of changes for those types of things. We were really lucky on this movie that the music that John Debney did and the sound effects that Sean and Kami did worked so well together. A couple of my favorite moments in the show are moments where we actually have lack of sound to make the point rather than a bunch of sound.
That we had to use for any of these scenes, I mean, not just the Foley stuff, but for crowds and all that, I mean, rather than using just one sound effect for something, because you know, you have 18 minutes of beating, you know, going on, and you have to have all these different situations, and so it doesn't sound so repetitious. You know, and just breaking everything down to like the sound of the leather and the sound of the chain on the leather and the sound of the shells and all that that were on the whips and all that. Every moment of it, every little bit of it was just adding so much intensity to it. So when we first played it for Mel, we were all actually kind of afraid, like, you know, what is he going to say? We only have these sounds peeled out for him. And he was like, I want more of this. This is good. I want people to feel the pain that he went through.
That's another one of those scenes that was kind of interesting, where we took the sound out as in slow pieces at a time, so that we ultimately got down to just, it was just, I think it was just the sound of the whoosh of the whip, so we didn't even hear the impact of it, and then Jesus' breaths, his reactions to that. And it was very carefully taken down in stages. You're just about at the point where you can't handle hearing one more whip when all of a sudden you'd hear the score come up, and then the sound of those things would come down.
Well, when we went and we sat with John and Mel, one of the things that John had mentioned, that the cross was its own character, the same as Jesus is a character. So we had to come up with not just a piece of timber that was bouncing around with some metal rings on it. We put many different layers, everything from an actual piece of wood to some big hollow plastic pipes, and try to give it its own vocal piece throughout it. And then all the different textured surfaces that we see it being dragged across, tonally, we had to change that so that the cross didn't sound exactly the same throughout the entire movie. Right to the final point where they prop them up and that slides into the ground, as far as the voice of the cross, that was the most impact within the movie.
The process was very simple. Every couple of days I would take and write, and then John and Mel would come over, and we'd tear it apart. And there were things that Mel would love for right off the bat, other things that took me 10, 11, 12 attempts to get to them. But it was very much trial and error. And the other part of the score, which is a little different for me, was there was a lot of experimentation with sound and different very ethnic instruments from all over the world. Because I think Mel's desire ultimately was to create a world sort of feeling for the score, that it would encompass many cultures of the world and many different spiritual feelings from different cultures. So he did not want to limit the score, in other words, to choir and an orchestra. And so that's why it's sort of varied in its construction.
Knowing the way that Mel wanted to see this shot, and knowing the impact that it was intended to have or is going to have on the audience, the last thing I wanted to do was deal with a prosthetic blending edge, you know, in the area that's closest to the camera, which of course was Jim's hand. So it was immediately identified as one of those shots that was going to be a combination of makeup effects and visual effects. Digital effects really have their place, but it isn't in photorealistic human form, you know, and immediately in front of your face on the screen. So what we did is identified it as a visual effects shot. We went down the road of creating a prosthetic element that we would use as a reference piece. And then, of course, we experimented even with that as, you know, can it be done to get it all on camera?
To further talk about that shot, because it was very clever the way you guys designed it, you know, we basically shot Jim lying on the cross, the hand came out, his hand went down, and another hand came up on the other side, and then later these guys added the nail going in. And, you know, and we had, when we were filming it, we had to, you know, pull focus from his face to something that wasn't really happening, and then back to Jim's face. But Ted was there when we were doing it, so when we were lining it up, he was able to give us an idea about what was important about the perspective and all those other things, so.
Awful lot of this was shot at a different speed than 24 frames.
I mean,
amazing. I mean, astounding. A lot of dialogue scenes.
Our first meeting with John, and we were sitting there, we watched the movie, and we talked a little bit, and John turned around and said, oh, you know, there's a lot of shots in this movie that are off speed. And, you know, in the middle of a conversation, I went, oh, okay, you know, no big deal. We got back to the editing room, and the film came in, and we started loading, and nothing was matching. Nothing was matching.
It wasn't even there.
It wasn't even there. You know, it was like a different place. You know, we kept trying to match the stuff, and nothing was coming together. And I called up John, and John's like, oh, I told you, everything's off speed. Like, oh,
dialogue.
Doing dialogue scenes.
The off-speed dialogue, it gave the movie a very kind of, I think, really neat kind of feel to it, you know? I mean, even the eyes blinking, just that slight change, it just changes
the emotion of, you know, someone, you know, when they're looking and they blink their eyes and turn and look at 40 frames is different than if you just see them do it at normal speed. Yeah. And it adds weight to things, too. I mean, like carrying the cross and, you know, some of the movement, it just adds a certain kind of weight and a certain kind of a emotional feel to it that wouldn't exist if you shot it at normal speed. Francesca Frigeri, the production designer, built, you know, the scenes that we did in Jerusalem and the streets and stairways that would lead into Matera. And there were frameworks left up from Gangs of New York. And in order to save money, you know, Francesco designed a lot of the sets to actually go on the scaffolding that had been left over from Gangs of New York. And so some of the design came from that, but within that design, he added the stairways and, you know, the doorways and you know, the various arches that would lead us into the scenes that ended up in Matera.
Steve McAveedy walked up to me one day while we were shooting and said, you know, Mel kind of wants to do a shot that's God's point of view. I just went, oh, goody. You know, it's like, one thing, I've done aerial shots looking down before, and a landscape never looks like from the air what you think it's going to look like. So I pretty much knew that we were probably going to have to design what the top of that hill looked like.
And Caleb, did you and Keith and his team, did you choreograph the wound reveals and in terms of capturing it on camera?
Only a couple of places where you actually see it. I mean, one we actually did with a motion control camera so that they could repeat it on what, you know, what they were doing, which was a shot of his back, of Jesus' back, and the camera just sort of moves around it. And then there was another wide shot, you know, with the archway in the background. But there really isn't a lot. I mean, then there was a close-up of his face when he gets hit and he gets the scar on his face. And, I mean, it's actually less than you think, but emotionally you feel there's a ton more than there is.
How many versions do you go through to create that emotional feel in the audience?
Mel and I had a lot of discussions about that scene, and I was always sort of battling with him to make it shorter. And I won a little and lost a lot. That was a tough scene to cut, let me tell you.
Bruce, one thing that's interesting about that scene that you were just talking about is you guys know the emotion that you had in your stomach just now when you were watching it. It wasn't any less for us while we were working on it. I mean, it was like, I mean, we've done a lot of films, and it's just hard to do. And
we tried to keep the atmosphere as light as we could, but when you're looking at that image and you're making those sounds and you're making those moves, it was a pit in our stomach.
Well, it sounds like, I mean, you guys really pushed the envelope with technology and with new techniques in a lot of the things that you did on the film. But it also sounds like you were also changed personally through the experience. And we can't thank you all enough. It's an exquisite film. And thank you very much for joining us tonight.